You are watching a close-up look at animal welfare issues with your host, writer, speaker, and advocate, Tina Evangelista-Eppenstein. This show is supported in part by animalwelfareissues.com, spotlighting issues around the globe. Check out the latest TV shows, articles, podcasts, and more. That's animalwelfareissues.com. Now here's your host, Tina, in 3, 2, 1.
Hi, I am Tina Evangelista-Eppenstein, and thanks for tuning in for this show. Tonight, we're going to focus in the majestic monarch butterfly, but before I get to that and my butterfly expert here, I like to take the time to recognize World Animal Day, which is coming up on October the 4th. This is an international day, as you can see up on the screen there, where animal advocates across the globe are celebrating animals. And our mission is to raise awareness about the plight of animals. We are also raising awareness that animals, this is all animals, are sentient beings, and we want animals to be treated more humanely. And this is being held on October the 4th, and that is the Feast of Assisi. And it's actually after the Saint Francis Assisi. He was the patron saint of animals. And I am the U.S. Ambassador for World Animal Day, so you can make a difference for animals on October the 4th or any other day of the year. It only takes one person to make a small difference. You don't need to belong to a large animal organization to do that. You can do whatever you want any day of the year, but this is our National Day of Recognition. But in all my 9 years of hosting this show, I have covered so many topics about so many animals, but one topic I've never covered, and that is the majestic monarch butterfly. And I'm so excited because my husband and I have been raising monarch caterpillars for the very first time this year. And joining me, I have a butterfly expert. He is an author of Attracting Butterflies, A Handbook for Butterfly Gardening. And I want to welcome Ron Ryle. Ron, thank you so much. I am so excited for you to be here. This is our first year, and the transformation to watch a little tiny egg turn into a caterpillar and into this gorgeous monarch butterfly it's so amazing for my husband and me. And as I said, this is our first year. But right now, the migration from Mexico is on. Can you tell the viewers why the migration to Mexico is so important?
Yes, the monarchs in the summertime only live 4 to 6 weeks. The last batch of monarchs are a brighter orange, and they go to Mexico and live as a butterfly. They overwinter as a butterfly for 7 months. They don't mate before they go. They fly straight to Mexico. And then the third week of March, they leave up in the mountains. Most of them go to Rosario, west of Mexico City. It's 10,000 feet up. By the way, discovered in 1976, so fairly recent, actually. And they leave there the third week of March. They fly to Texas and lay eggs on the milkweed there. That's their host plant. If we didn't have milkweed, there'd be no monarchs. That's the plant they depend on for their life cycle. So the monarchs that are born in Texas come to Pennsylvania and go all the way up to Canada.
So the monarchs that are making that trek down to Mexico, they will not make it back to Pennsylvania. It will be their offspring or their grandchildren.
That's right. Yeah, it'll be the next generation.
Right.
Now this year we might have had four generations. We won't know till the season's completely over. The migration will last all the way through October and probably into the first week of November. Last year we had an incredible October migration. This year I've had in the backyard in Pottstown, so far I've had 150 monarchs, which really isn't that many. Last year I had 384 total for the entire migration. In the old days, years ago, I used to get 200 a day. I haven't been able to reach that for several years. They land on Mexican sunflower. Could you pass that orange flower over, Tina?
Sure.
Thank you very much. This is the plant that, if you want to see the migration at your home, they'll land on this. It's native to Mexico. They recognize it. So Mexican sunflower is a magic nectar attractor on their trip down. They don't need a lot of nectar to get there, but inside here is sugar water, so they stop in my backyard, which is only 50 feet by 50 feet, and 90% of them go on the Mexican sunflower. So this is a very important flower for me. I keep a backup supply in case something happens. Lately, the rain has been knocking them down, so we're hoping to have enough nectar through October. And in the wild right now, the only nectar they can really find is goldenrod and also late-flowering boneset. So those are the main two nectar flowers in the wild. So it's nice to have something for them to eat on the way down to Mexico.
So these butterflies right here, they are on their way to Mexico.
These butterflies here were captured today on their way to Mexico. It's a pretty good flying day. We've had a lot of rain lately, so finally we got a day where they can move around. We've had about 15 come through the backyard today, which is really not that many. I did capture, I think I've got seven in there in the cage, and I'll be letting them go later today because I don't like to keep them caged up. I was feeding them sugar water before I got here in a sponge, but they can go a while without any nectar or sugar water. You can also use Gatorade when you have them in the cage. They'll drink that too out of a sponge. So
do you have more females or males, or is it even?
Well, should we get one out or?
Sure.
Yeah, I'd like to show you how dark the last generation, the one that goes to Mexico, is a darker orange. I think this is one of the males here. Yeah, this one's not as orange as some of them.
Do you want to explain why, how you can detect if it's a male or female?
Yeah, it has the two dots on the bottom two wings. I'm trying to get those up there. This is not easy. You don't want to damage them. On those bottom two wings, there's those two black dots. I got to move one of my fingers there. Finally, yeah. I did that. So anyway, they're very strong. Just about pull the hair. You can see that, how strong that thing is. They have jagged legs, and sometimes they need that. And then at night, they rest up in the tall trees. The smaller butterflies rest on the ground in the vegetation on the ground. These guys spend the night up in the trees. So they'll be going to Mexico right after the show here. And by the way, Mexico is southwest. So when you're driving around this week, when you see a monarch, I saw a couple on the way up to Redding from Pottstown this afternoon. Watch and you'll see they're flying southwest. That's where Mexico is. It's not south. So they're all flying southwest. If we were to release these right now, being that they were caught in the wild, they would go southwest immediately. Sometimes when you raise them, they it takes them a while to get oriented before they go southwest. But these guys, they're going to go southwest right away.
So let's go back to finding eggs or caterpillars, okay? And how do you find them? I mean, people say, you know, they don't ever see any caterpillars. What do you need so that you can see them?
Okay. You need to grow milkweed. There's three native milkweeds in Pennsylvania. One of them is the orange butterfly weed, Asclepias tuberosa. That's the orange milkweed. There's swamp milkweed. And their preference up between, there's one more, and that's common milkweed, and that's the one they really prefer. Here we have one caterpillar on the common milkweed here. It was just eating a while ago out here on the end of the leaf. You can see there's some missing. It's been eating quite a bit the last few minutes. This one here, I think we're going to have, it's going to be a caterpillar probably for another, I would say, 5 or 6 days, and then it'll make a chrysalis after that. And you need milkweed. If you don't have milkweed, no monarchs will, you won't.
They won't survive. We won't have any whatsoever. That is the host plant.
This is the host plant. And what's happening in the Midwest, most of the monarchs live along the Susquehanna River. And there's those big 1,000-acre farms out there, and the farmers use Roundup before they plant their corn and wheat, soybeans, and they're killing all the milkweed. And around here, local farmers, dairy farmers, don't like milkweed because it's toxic to cows. So plant milkweed You know, the farmers, they're not going to promote it because it's not helpful to what they want to do.
But aren't the monarchs' numbers, haven't they been decreasing, or have they gradually increased now? Because they were, their numbers are really down, the population numbers.
Well, that's a question that could be answered two different ways. Last year in Mexico, they they fly overhead. It's the World Wildlife Foundation. They fly an airplane over, and they had 2.4 hectares of monarchs. A hectare, 2.4 hectares is, I think it's around six acres. And they think there might be like a million monarchs to a hectare. And other people think there's more. So there's still millions of monarchs, but it was way down compared to other years. Sometimes it's up around 10 hectares. So it was only 2.4.
But it had been down. Their numbers had been down. And won't it take private citizens to plant milkweed? I mean, are we making a dent in it at all in the numbers by raising them?
I think private citizens are really helping out the cause here, because there's a lot of people doing this statewide now, and especially in our area. If you leave the monarch out in the wild, the scientists say they have a 1 out of 400 chance, the egg itself, from going from egg to butterfly, a 1 out of 400 chance of survival.
It's because of predators. Predators will eat the eggs. It will eat the caterpillars of all sizes.
That and rain.
Yes.
Rain will kill eggs. We've had a lot of rain this year. This was a unique year. I actually saw female monarchs laying eggs in the rain in several different days.
And they don't normally do that? No, I haven't seen it.
I didn't think so, but somebody said, you know, they do what they got to do.
Yeah.
Time is of the essence. And the reason they start going to Mexico this time of year, the days become shorter, and they figure that out, it's time to leave. So they head out. Usually in Pottstown, it starts around September 1st. And what I do is I catch three or four. I throw them up in the air. If they go southwest, the migration's underway. And I did that again this year, and it happened right around September 1st or 2nd. So that's when they start out from Pottstown.
Did you have butterflies prior to that? Were you raising the caterpillars? I mean, they start, like you say, in March, April, May, and June.
Yeah, this year I raised about 100 monarchs, which is a big number for me. I usually only do 20 to 40. I do research on all the butterflies, and last year we had 42 species. This year only 30. The monarch butterfly is doing very well this year in Pennsylvania, at least. But the other butterflies overall, they're way, way down. So we have a lot of work to do.
Why are they down now?
Butterflies. We don't really know. The rain probably had something to do with the life cycle. And a lot of them didn't stay in the backyard much this year. When they're looking for mates, they don't hang around. You see them flying fast, they're looking for a mate. So I saw a lot of them that just didn't want to hang around. They're like, they're just there for a minute. And I like to have like the same butterfly hang around for like two or three days, actually. That's my goal. But
so their numbers are down.
This year, what I did is I raised most of them from eggs. I had, in the city, a lot of times I don't get a lot of monarch caterpillars. Sometimes only get 9 or 10. This year, I had female monarchs laying eggs, I'd say 35 days straight. It was incredible, actually. So I mostly raised my my monarch butterflies from eggs this year. It's a little white. I don't have an egg with me today. I did look today. I couldn't find
it. Can you show that? I have a picture of an egg. There are actually two eggs on a leaf. They're so tiny, you may not even see it, but is that a caterpillar or
that's
that
a caterpillar
egg?
There.
Yeah.
There we go.
There. These are two eggs that we had. They're so tiny, and if you're not looking for them, you will probably miss them. But from those little tiny pinhead eggs.
You get a caterpillar in about 4 days. Would you believe the first day you can't even see the caterpillar? Day two, you probably can't see it either.
I know.
They eat a hole straight through the leaf. They have some kind of chemical in them, and they just go right through there. But I don't think you can even see them with a magnifying glass. So
I saw them when they hatched. And I was using a magnifying glass,
good.
And you see
good
the
work.
Little black, awesome. that top of the head. Yeah, I watched them. Yeah, I'm really, really into
good
that.
Stuff.
Yeah.
And you raised about 70 your first year?
We had 77 caterpillars.
Wow.
Now, 8 of them died as a result of the tachinid fly, unfortunately.
Okay.
And let's see, 5 were caterpillar stage and 3 in the chrysalis stage. So that's very disappointing.
I lost about 15 to that tachinid fly.
You want to explain what that is?
it's a small fly, and I believe it lays the eggs on the caterpillar. And then, or maybe, is it inside or is it right on the outside surface?
They raise them, I mean, they lay them on the outside and they burrow.
Yeah, and they burrow through, and you end up, your caterpillar turns black, or the chrysalis turns back black. The monarch chrysalis.
I just wanted to say, this tachinid fly, it's growing inside
the
caterpillar.
It's jade green. The chrysalis is a jade green. You can see the wings in this one if you really get up close. The butterfly should be coming out in a few days here. I would say, I'm going to take a guess. I'll say about 3 or 4 days. So these would turn black if you have that tachinid fly problem. And I lost about 15, so that was kind of disappointing. But other people even had worse problems this year.
Really?
So it was an up and down year. Janice Good from Boyertown, she will have raised 500 monarchs off her property. That's incredible. She didn't get much disease at all, so she had pretty close to 100% success, which is incredible.
That's great. But this tachinid fly, they're maggots that are inside. They're larvae, and when they hatch, they're eating this caterpillar, you know, either when it's dying or dead, and then they come out either of the caterpillar or of the chrysalis. And it breaks my heart to see a caterpillar go through, into a jay and then dying because of this tachinid fly.
And there's not much you can do about that tachinid fly.
No.
They're real small. I've actually seen them finally. I know what they look like, but it's just part of nature.
Oh, I have a picture, I think, of the maggot. And the one, it's with the chrysalis, if you can show that by any chance. No, that's the...
There's one.
That's a newly hatched monarch.
Coming out.
It's like a little white maggot. But anyway, just to stay on this. This is, you have the chrysalis. This is one that's just emerged. The wings are a little bit full there. There's just not immediately after. And
yeah, it takes time for them to get the fluid to come all the way through the wings.
Right. And when they come out, their bodies are huge because they're filled with fluid. And you can see them like squeezing and then pushing that into their wings. I mean,
it's amazing.
If you can show the chrysalis when it's completely dark by any chance to show right there. This is our first one, our very first one that we had, and that's a faux plant. He climbed off our milkweed and went on to there, and this is right before he was ready to emerge, and you can just see them crystal clear, and that's what will happen when they're ready to emerge. And I guess some, if they have a disease or something, won't come out. We haven't had any issues, but I know some other people have.
Well, sometimes you get curled wings. They say it's humidity. I had trouble with some curled wings this year.
Really? We haven't had
them. Nothing you can
do
about it. You know, you just can't get them. You cannot have 100% success. You'd like to, but
yeah,
and that's our goal.
So the humidity can affect their...
Yeah, it can. So I forgot to mention, when I was handling that monarch butterfly, if you did that to any other butterfly, you would destroy it. This is the strongest butterfly that I know of. Those black lines are like a skeleton on the monarch butterfly.
I didn't know that.
So if we would have had a swallowtail here, we would have all kinds of wings laying on the table with us. So this is really the only butterfly you can handle like that. I know a lot of you viewers are wondering, how did you do that? Well, the monarch is very, very strong compared to the other butterfly species.
They are called the king of the butterflies. Why is that?
I don't
because
know.
They are so strong, or they're...
I don't know.
I just want to show a video here of one of them opening up. If you can just show that clip, I just want to show the viewers what it's really like to watch a monarch emerge. It's really amazing.
Turns black and then clear. And that's when the butterfly, the monarch butterfly, emerges, when it becomes clear.
And he's using his legs You can see it at the top or the bottom.
Yeah, it's starting to move there, I think.
And their head's at the bottom right now. And they're pushing their way out with their legs. Every time I see it happening.
It's like a miracle.
It is.
It's really neat.
It's like, how did a caterpillar?
It's fundraising the monarch butterfly, and I might add, it's actually easier than the other butterflies.
I didn't know that.
A lot of them you have to put a stick in with them to make a chrysalis, and the monarch caterpillar will make a chrysalis on a lid. It likes a roof, in other words. So you don't have to put the stick in, so it's a little bit less work. Although it is a lot of work cleaning the cages. They go to the bathroom a lot.
It's a lot of work.
So you get up in the morning, you clean the cages, you get the fresh milkweed leaves, you put those in. And it's a lot like milking the cows. Yeah, it takes time.
It does. It's very time.
It takes a half hour to an hour. And if you have a lot of them, it takes a couple hours. Oh, isn't that something? Look at that.
I know. I never tire of it. It's like this little miracle coming out.
And they actually have the straw that they drink with. They drink the nectar with their, it can be pronounced two different ways, proboscis or proboscis. And they actually assemble that, I understand. They put that together after they're born.
Right.
So that's their straw. That's how they get their nectar. Look at that. Oh, there's the straw already?
Yeah. Wow. No, they have to zip it. They have to work on that's the.
They have to work on it?
Yeah, that's one of the first things that they do. They work on that proboscis. And,
all right.
To get that together, because if they can't get that together, the two pieces, they can't drink, and therefore they will die themselves.
Yeah. So, you gotta be able to eat.
So as a caterpillar, they do a lot of eating, and there's a lot of frass, which is, another term for going to the bathroom. There is a ton of it if you have, the large caterpillars. But as a butterfly, they just drink.
Oh, this one just went to the bathroom here.
And that's what they do. I mean, if they're constantly eating, you will have that. And it is a lot of work because you need to keep the place clean. A
little piece of black.
For the monarchs.
There's the excrement, I call it, right there. So let's put that in the jar here so we don't get that on the table. There we go.
But we've had caterpillars, and I love caterpillars. I think they're so cute. I think they're really, really amazing. If we could just show a few pictures that I brought with. I've taken lots and lots of photographs like you have, and I just want to show this book then. But if you can show, this, he was sleeping. And he was so cute. He was eating, and then he had to take a break. And then I have another one. They stretch and turn. I already thought one similar to him was dying, because there's that, is it MPV, where they do an inverted V, and they fall down, but they fool you. And I think sometimes they play dead, quote unquote. And if you show the other one, that one, he didn't move. He just stayed like that.
Uh-huh.
And then when I put him back on another leaf, he was perfectly fine. Then we had caterpillars, though, who fought. And we had a lot of milkweed. And they still fought. Is that normal?
I've never seen that, actually. It
really?
Could happen, though.
Can you just show just a tiny bit of the video? They were really, really fighting, really biting at each other.
Okay.
And right. And we moved them.
Okay.
You know.
Got some nice milkweed leaves there. And this time of year, the milkweeds are turning yellow, but they'll eat anything just to survive at this point. And there's still caterpillars in the wild, so.
I mean, obviously, you have one.
Yes, different people still have a few. And the migration will go all the way through to the first week of November, so. Keep watching. You have to cut your plants back during the season. If you use butterfly bush, you have to cut it back about three times to have nectar in September. And then the Mexican sunflower, I deadhead that right now. I deadhead that every day, actually, to try to keep the new blooms coming. So you really have to keep up with it at the end of the year. It's hard to have any nectar for the migration to feed the monarchs their nectar on the way to Mexico.
I just want to say, they were really fighting up there. This is your book, and you wrote this, was it in 2009?
It was in 2010.
Okay.
2010. And the idea of the book is how to attract butterflies. I become more and more into conservation as time goes on. That's pretty much where I'm at now. But if you follow the instructions in the book, you're going to see a lot of butterflies. The number one attractor, surprisingly, is Verbena bonariensis. It's not a native. And then Buddleia butterfly bush number two, Mexican sunflower number three. Every butterfly likes Mexican sunflower, so it's a monarch magnet, and all the other butterflies like it too.
Our neighbor has that, and we get
I sell these there. Plants. Common milkweed, hardly any nursery in the state grows it. I'm one of the largest milkweed growers in the state. You have to freeze the seeds. They need ice. The seeds need ice to germinate. It's a tricky process. I just finished a three-year study on it, and I have a typed-up document on that if anybody needs it. The more ice, the better for germination. You can plant thousands and thousands of seeds, so never come up. They need ice.
I just want to show one quick video of releasing a butterfly, and then I want to share your last few thoughts. This is our first butterfly, and we put him on a flower because he didn't want to leave. Come on, sweetie. Where did he go? And he was gone.
All right. Well, you guys had a great year at your house.
Yeah, I mean,
where'd he go?
Don't know if it's beginner's luck, but
awesome.
Yeah.
Back in 2004, the monarch migration, I think I had around 20 monarchs for the whole migration. I'm one of the few people that even saw any. So they're doing a little better now.
But, so I was in 2004.
2004 was one tough year.
So we have 1 minute left. What are your last thoughts for anybody who's interested in wanting to raise monarchs?
Well, it's a good thing to do. It's a noble thing because it's all about conservation. By saving the monarch butterfly, you're helping the other pollinators. This spring was especially difficult with the cold spring and the rain. The pollinators, from bees to butterflies, were all down. Some of the local orchards were complaining. And there's even an orchard in Carlisle. They rent, it's an apple orchard. They rent a semi-truckload of honeybees every year. So it's just a good thing to do. And it's very intriguing as well. It'll get you interested in conserving all the insects, and we need them for our food supply.
Yeah, I've never appreciated insects more than I do now. It's not just monarchs, but just more intrigued and interested in all these insects. I want to thank you for joining me here today.
Well, thank
I really,
you.
Really
fun.
Appreciate it. And October the 4th, World Animal Day, you too can make a difference. It just takes one person to make a change in an animal's life. Thank you for tuning in. We'll see you next time.